who's gay, who's not in Hollywood. That's news.
Let's not name anyone because we don't want to get ourselves into great trouble.
Not ready to come out yet?
No.
Hollywood has always had a hypocritical relationship with homosexuals.
But you're not a girl, you're a guy. And why would a guy want to marry a guy? Security.
Today, you're not going to have another Rock Hudson who can be gay and be in the closet and play all these leading man roles.
Oh, please. Oh, please. Of course it could occur today.
What have you heard?
I think it's one of the last taboos. I think it will crack.
From Thomas Edison's 1895 short film featuring two men dancing to David Lynch's erotic thriller Mulholland Drive, homosexuality and gay characters have always been a part of the movies. But the relationship between Hollywood and homosexuality has been a complicated and difficult one. Being gay, publicly, is still one of Tinseltown's biggest taboos.
Hollywood is basically run on homosexual fuel. The editors at the magazines, the producers, the actors, there's so much homosexual fuel in this town, yet somehow gay actors can't be outwardly gay.
It's very interesting that despite the apparent total explicitness about sexuality in today's media world, that homosexuality remains a taboo. It still is a burden for a performer.
Being gay still is one of the deep secrets. People can have children out of wedlock, and Angelina Jolie can kiss her brother on national television, and yet we all just kind of roll with it, whatever. But being gay still has that feeling of, well, this could be the big shock.
Paul.
Shh. What the fuck is going on here? Who the fuck are you?
Ben Affleck can go into substance abuse treatment and it doesn't phase his career. Whereas somebody else, if they were outed for being a lesbian or for being gay, it could limit what they could do on the screen because people wouldn't buy them in a part.
I can only tell you how much I love you. I can only tell you all.
Yeah, Mama.
Part of the appeal to the American public, the movie-going public, is seeing a star in a role thinking, he would fall in love with me. They want to blur the line between reality and the movie, and they want to be the lady up there on the screen, and they do have this fantasy. If only I were in that role, then I could be like that person. It's incredibly unrealistic. A woman has as much chance of having, you know, a gay man fall in love with her as she does this hunky leading star, but they can't accept that because then the fantasy is destroyed.
Darling, how I love you, my darling.
If you're a star and you are homosexual and you don't want the public to know about it, the reason ultimately is dollars and cents. I think you alienate a huge chunk of your audience. For better or worse, there are people in America, there are people in this world who just don't accept that lifestyle. And if you come out and you say, I'm gay, I'm proud of it, and you have a movie coming out, that's going to cut your box office potentially in half.
When Tom Cruise was suing over that rumor that he had an affair with a gay wrestler, the actual lawsuit stated the reason that this is damaging to his career and could be financially damaging to him is because women go to see him in movies because he's a sex symbol. And if he is labeled as a homosexual, that will hurt him financially.
The issue of being a gay celebrity, for musicians, it's not that big of a deal. Millions of fans, a female, male, who love Elton John, they don't really care about his sexual orientation. You know, but if Elton John was trying to play some sort of ladies' man in all of his movies, if he was an actor, he would have a problem with that. So it's not necessarily homophobia or anything like that. It's just a matter of audiences not being able to separate the person from the character that they're playing.
The facts are that from the very beginning of the industry in Hollywood, a century ago, there's been a higher percentage of gays and lesbians than probably anywhere else in the country, simply because they are attracted to the various industry disciplines that are here.
These are people who are drawn to the theater, to the world of make-believe, to the world of illusion, to the world of recreating a reality. This became a haven for these marginalized people. You have to remember that in times prior to our modern understanding of sexuality, there was no division between gay and straight. In fact, the invention of homosexuality meant that heterosexuality was suddenly invented. In the 1920s, with all these artistic people in Hollywood, with all these people kind of already pushing the edges of definition and already kind of rethinking their place in the world, of course we're going to see a lot of experimentation and openness and tolerance.
Movies were just coming of age. There was drinking, but it was all illegal. The country is having a great big party. Our morals were a lot looser.
The sexual revolution of the 20s was actually far greater than even the sexual revolution of the 70s, because it really broke with the Victorian trend of very conventional, rigid morality. Women were smoking cigarettes, they were raising their skirts. There was an ambivalence around, not only around gender roles, but around sexuality. There was a sense that maybe we could play a little differently, we could find a new set of rules.
If you look back, you can see that some of the great icons had a subtly bisexual quality to them. Valentino was a very interesting actor because he was, in a way, one of the first public males to a degree, exhibit his feminine side.
Most people realized that he was bisexual. I mean, he sort of went any way that the opportunity presented itself.
He was a softer hero. It's a very un-American kind of sexuality that he was projecting. You can see why women went for Valentino if you go look at his movies. He was a very attractive guy.
There was a sense that the tide was turning a little bit. There was a headline, it was the Chicago Tribune or one of those, where it said, Valentino is a pink powder puff. Basically a warning to the Hollywood studios. The public isn't going to put up with this for much longer. We've got all these stars out there prancing around and men who are looking more like women than the women are on the screen. At some point, the public is going to react against this and there will be a backlash. And indeed, there was.
Hairy-chested American journalism of the time began questioning his masculine credentials. He reacted badly to that, challenging him to duels and boxing matches and what have you. He was kind of a sad case, actually.
In an effort to assert his masculinity, Valentino set up a series of boxing matches and challenges. Soon thereafter, he found himself in emergency surgery with a ruptured appendix. 8 days later, he died. 80,000 mourners in New York caused a riot while waiting to pay their respects to the Powder Puff, cinema's original screen lover.
There were a number of scandals in Hollywood that began to raise the bar. People began to suspect Hollywood of being a bed of immorality.
Hollywood really was becoming a kind of a Babylon. It discovered it could make quick and easy profits through selling sex. But then there was an outcry nationwide from women's groups and also from religious organizations, and particularly the Catholic Church. Hollywood began to clean up its act and adopted a series of these Hays codes, with the ultimate one being in the early 1930s, the production code that lasted well into the 50s.
Code sets up high standards of performance for motion picture producers. You want entertainment, wholesome, interesting, and vital. This the motion picture industry is pledged to provide.
Under the guidance of William Hays, Hollywood studios enacted a series of self-regulated codes to establish standards of good taste. These specific do's and don'ts were particularly harsh about depictions of sexuality, especially homosexuality.
It changed the philosophy of the movies. The movies were, up until that point, pushing the edges of convention. They were scandalous, really, and Suddenly in 1933, when we had this, the production code enforced, Hollywood became a place of affirming the status quo. What matters is the nuclear family, heterosexuality, loyalty to Jesus Christ.
You know, Shirley, heaven's a very nice place. If we're good, we'll all live there someday.
Yes, I know.
Any mention of homosexuality in any way in film or anywhere was absolutely forbidden.
Cockeyed philosophies of life, ugly sex situations, cheap jokes, and dirty dialogue are not wanted. Decent people don't like this sort of stuff, and it is our job to see to it that they get none of it.
Suddenly, in the new decade, these effeminate stars didn't just suggest a certain style, they suggested deviance.
Next, the double life of Hollywood's quintessential leading man.
Clearly, there was some demand given to Cary Grant to get away from Scott and get married, because he suddenly marries and almost immediately has a nervous breakdown.
Sniff and stiff!
To follow.
Could you teach me to play like Sniff and Stiff again?
Yeah, sure. Call Advanced Medical Institute and they can show you how.
1-800-211-211. 1930s, Hollywood, the golden age of the studio system. Movie stars were no longer actors. They were now stars. They were icons of perfection to be admired and loved by the public. But the fans were not getting the whole story.
Over here on your right, playing hide and seek, Gary Cooper and Frederick Munch.
If you were a movie studio, you had stars under a long-term contract, that meant you had a long-term economic interest in their careers. So you didn't want anything to happen to those careers. You didn't want them to have a sex scandal or a booze scandal or a drunken driving scandal or any of those things to happen. And it was famous. I mean, there were all kinds of cases out here where, you know, the studio publicist would arrive at the scene of the crime before the cops and abscond with whatever evidence was on the scene, you know?
Let me just say that the police were the very last people called when there was a celebrity scandal or crime. They had complete control over celebrities' lives. You're gay, you're married to this woman over here, or this man over here. There were beards in the old days, and there are beards today. That term means a set-up wife or husband.
The stars back then were under very, very strict morals contracts. They even had to dress in a certain way when they went outside. And if they didn't, they were fined.
You misbehaved, you could be put on suspension. What happened with suspension is it added all the time you were on suspension to the other end of the contract. So you could become, as a number of stars said, a slave in Hollywood. Hollywood protects its own. The problem arises, though, when something happens that explodes a scandal, a gay scandal, for example, into national consciousness. And that happened in 1933 when a really popular actor named William Haynes, Billy Haynes, got caught by the police with a sailor at the downtown YMCA. Louis B. Mayer fired him because he couldn't bury the scandal at that point.
He was a huge, huge, huge star, the number one box office star in 1930, and lived openly with his partner. And it was acknowledged by the studios, by many of the fan magazines, in that they would say, you know, Billy Haynes arrived at this premiere or at Marion Davies' party with his companion, Jimmy Shields. And Billy Haynes, by being this kind of wisecracking bachelor who winked and flitted across the screen and refused to get married and told gossip columnists, you know, I'm too busy buying antiques to think about getting married. You know what I mean? He was just suddenly too out there.
Billy Haynes, who was smarter than most, then went on and got his revenge by becoming the richest interior designer in Hollywood.
Willie Haynes became a cautionary tale for gay actors working in this radically different Hollywood. The message was clear. If a performer was gay, they were expected to hide it from the public.
The studios, which of course controlled the actors at that time, saw to it that a mass retreat happened. Everything became really straight in Hollywood.
The gender-ambiguous male stars of the 1920s, people like Valentino, William Haynes, they were replaced by these ultra-masculine, ultra-heterosexual stars like Clark Gable and Spencer Tracy and Jimmy Cagney. But that male softness didn't entirely disappear. It went into the supporting players.
One such supporting player was the young, dapper Cary Grant. With his classic good looks and athletic build, Cary Grant was cast as the object of desire to a legion of screen goddesses.
Why don't you come up sometimes, see me? I'm home every evening.
Yeah, but I'm busy every evening.
Busy? So what are you trying to do, insult me?
Why, no, not at all. I'm just busy, that's all.
Cary Grant was an acrobat in England and all, came to New York, had a gay lover there, came to Los Angeles 1932, fell in love with Randolph Scott, and the relationship was so flagrant that even a news radio commentator talked about it on the radio all the time.
They were lovers who shared a house together. The production code hits, you know, there's all sorts of ultimatums being offered. Clearly there was some demand given to Cary Grant to get away from Scott and get married, because he suddenly marries and almost immediately has a nervous breakdown.
Cary Grant married Virginia Sherrill, the first of his five marriages, and it was just as unhappy, apparently, as all the four that followed. He tried to commit suicide a couple of times, was a heavy drinking alcoholic.
After his divorce from Virginia Sherrill, Cary Grant moved back in with his lover, Randolph Scott. The two men even appeared together in the classic screwball comedy, My Favorite Wife.
He had given up so much in his life, you know, to be something else. He became Cary Grant. Cary Grant symbolized an awful lot to the culture.
You know what's wrong with you?
No, what?
Nothing.
And you must understand that Cary Grant once famously sued Chevy Chase, who in the 1970s referred to him on a television show as the homo.
Chevy Chase was speaking simply what the oral tradition was out there, that, you know, Cary Grant wasn't real, that behind the image there was a very different side. So of course, you know, after you spend a lifetime trying to create this image and then somebody comes along and tries to, you know, Liberace sued when he was called gay, you know, and that to me is the most absurd thing of all, and he won.
You won't object to removing your blouse, will you?
Men are titillated by the fact that women might be sexually attracted to each other.
I'm ready now.
So that's always been something that has had a place on the screen, even if it had to be somewhat coded.
I suppose you want these pulled down, won't you? Yes.
The gender ambivalence of a Dietrich or a Garbo in the 1930s, they were given more leeway, I think, in allowing their lesbian sexuality to come across on the screen.
Most lesbians know how to behave, and especially actresses, one can even get pregnant if one has to. Louis B. Mayer, who was the big boss of Metro-Goldwyn-Mayer, he, of course, said marry so-and-so and so-and-so. He married them all. They were called lavender marriages. When a lesbian actress married a homosexual or a gay actor, Barbara Stanwyck was the one that was deepest in the closet. She married Robert Taylor, who was gay, and that's a lavender marriage.
Marlena Dietrich had an affair with Claudette Colbert. And Marlena Dietrich even went so far as to make popular a fashion thing that was then a code for lesbianism, which was women wearing pants.
This was a woman who saw sexuality working
in many levels that were beyond the conventional. You know, and Dietrich personally, we know now, was very interested in women, as interested in them as in men. She had this marriage that lasted till the husband died, but it was a convenience, a facade behind which she could lead a much more complicated life.
Dietrich, I think, enjoyed men, whereas I think Garbo found men to be rather repellent, I think, at times. She lived a life that was very authentic from day one to the time she came from Hollywood to the time she left.
Morning, Ebba.
But, Your Majesty, you cannot tie an old maid.
I have no intention to, Chancellor. I shall die a bachelor.
You can see how deep the lesbians lived in the closet, deeper than the boys in many ways. The boys were more out running around to see if they could find a little trick here and there. The girls didn't dare.
Next, how the stars of the 1950s coped in the radically different world of sensational tabloid exposés.
James Dean was probably bisexual.
Rumors about gay relationships were breaking all over the place at the time of his death.
Kiss me. Can't hear.
Ernest, I'm so happy you were able to come.
You must excuse my coming in my tarn clothes, but your chauffeur said there wasn't a moment to lose, so I came just as I am.
From 1933 on, Hollywood has always had a hypocritical relationship with homosexuals. Because on the one hand, after the production code, they could no longer present homosexuals in positive or sympathetic portrayals on the screen. They had to affirm heterosexuality. They had to fire anybody who was too out there, who was too outrageous or indiscreet. But at the same time, there were so many gay people employed in all walks of the studio life that there was an acceptance and a tolerance within the industry for gay people. And in fact, it was one of the more open and tolerant places for gay people to work.
In the 1950s, the U.S. fell under Joseph McCarthy's cloud of censorship. With his Committee on Un-American Activities, McCarthy created a culture of fear and suppression stretching from Washington, D.C. to Hollywood.
Gay people weren't targeted in the same way that communists were. Certainly, gayness was linked to communism and to subversion. So the tightrope that gay stars, gay actors had to walk in the 1950s was far more taut and far more treacherous than even in the first years after the production code, because now they had so many guns aimed at them, and they had such an image to protect. And they lived in a culture of fear.
Talk, talk, talk. Wonder how it would be to have someone to pillow talk with me. I wonder how.
What a marvelous looking man. I wonder if he's single.
I don't know how long I can get away with this act.
Rock Hudson was certainly one of the big stars. The fact that he was gay through all of that time was an open secret in Hollywood. But he was peddled by the studios, which had a lot to do with this, as the sort of a super stud.
Mr. Allen, I'm from the telephone company.
Well, hello.
I'm Miss Dickinson. I'm an inspector.
What would you like to inspect?
You. I mean, we've received a complaint about you.
He went out with starlets. He was photographed with them on his arm. He gave interviews to the fan magazine saying, you know, this is the kind of girl I'm looking for. He did all of the studio requirements to pretend that he was heterosexual. He married his agent's secretary, and, you know, it was an arranged marriage. I mean, that's clearly been shown now, and it was, you know, because Confidential magazine, shortly before that, they had exposed Tab Hunter as being gay, and Rock Hudson was the biggest star in the world. They had to find a way to keep him safe.
Don't you find me attractive?
Why, yes, ma'am, of course.
Is it in the best interest of the gay actor to be out? isn't it better to remain ambiguous? Because certainly the rumors about Rock Hudson were out there, even if they were not known to the audience. All of Hollywood certainly knew about it.
I don't know if James Dean, had he lived, would have had much of a career, because rumors about gay relationships were breaking all over the place at the time of his death.
Kiss me. Down here.
He was kept by a producer named Rogers Brackett for several years, who got him some early work before the big movies that he's always remembered for.
You're tearing me apart!
What?
You say one thing, he says another, and everybody changes back again!
James Dean was probably bisexual. When you go back and look at the film, you can see it. It shows. You look at the relationship between Dean and Sal Mineo in the film, and you say, oh, yeah, I get it.
Not ready to come out yet?
No.
There's a film from 1955 that's really working on a whole lot of different sexual planes.
Hey, you want to come home with me? I mean, there's nobody home at my house. Heck, I'm not tired. Are you? See, I don't have too many people I can talk to. Who has? If you want to come, we could talk, and in the morning we could have breakfast like my dad used to.
From what I know of James Dean's life, he was so young when he died. Maybe he was gay, maybe he was bisexual, maybe he was straight. He was a rebel. He really was a rebel, and he was perfect for that film. But he was a rebel in so many parts of his life that I could even see him, if he had lived, marrying somebody and having this real torrid relationship with a woman for a while. I mean, Marlon Brando was very similar.
Marlon, that's good enough. Now, will you turn your head for us?
Sure.
Around the other way.
Marlon Brando admitted to having relationships with men. It was kind of forgotten by the time he died that the Godfather had been, you know, fooling around with boys in the 50s and the 60s. But he admitted to that.
Hey, Stella!
The sexual liberation of the 60s and 70s had little impact for gays in Hollywood. While movies such as Midnight Cowboy pushed the sexual envelope, being an out gay actor remained a major taboo. The fact that gays and lesbians worked and lived in Hollywood was an industry secret, a secret that could no longer be contained with the coming of AIDS.
It was Rock Hudson who put AIDS on the map as an international story. There's no doubt about that. And of course, he did everything in his power to deny he had it, embittering everyone who knew him. You know, right to the, even his closest friends and lovers don't feel that he behaved ethically at the end about it.
There was a time with Rock Hudson, nobody talked about AIDS. It was very prevalent back then, but nobody talked about it. His death, his untimely death, brought it about where people could talk about it.
Rock Hudson adored women. He had so many women friends. He was a lovely man that he had to deny to his dying day. How he really felt about the world is, I find that very sad.
The idea of outing celebrities as gay or lesbian is as controversial today as it was in the 1950s. As rumors swirl about various high-profile performers, the unwritten rule persists. If it becomes public, their careers will end.
This is going to sound ridiculous. Generally speaking, gossip is true. You know, by the time it gets to the Inquirer, the kind of stuff that gets in there about people's divorces, people's affairs, people's addictions and stuff, I would say 90% of the time turns out to be true.
Where there's smoke, there's fire, most 99% of the times. And so I listen. When these stories persist year after year after year, I have found, historically speaking, they've always led back to some truth.
In 1991, actor Paul Rubens was arrested for indecent exposure after being found in a compromising position in a gay X-rated movie theater.
The Pee Wee Herman scandal was so overblown. I mean, God, he's the only person in a scandal alone. He's alone in a sex scandal and he's ruined because there was a taint of homosexuality to it. He was in a gay theater. Oh, well, he's one of those.
I meant to do that.
I love Pee-wee's Great Adventure. I think that the character that Rubens created was brilliant. But the problem with it was because it was a child-oriented persona that it made his arrest in a sleazy theater all the more shocking. His work hadn't been on the borderline of child and adult entertainment. I think that the reaction against him would not have been so extreme.
Do you understand you give up all your rights in this waiver of rights form, including the right to a trial?
Yes.
Did your attorneys, Mr. Dresnick, Mr. Gerstein, explain everything to you, sir?
Yes.
Paul Rubens once again made headlines in 2002 when police raided his personal collection of artwork, deeming it pornographic. The issue of homosexuality came up once again, as much of the artwork was gay in nature.
The second time that he was in the news for crimes, it was sort of a, is it art or is it pornography? And that's why we didn't hear so much about it, and it sort of went away. But the charge was that he had pornographic material depicting children.
Paul Rubens, I've been in his house, and he has an incredible collection of everything, not just vintage beefcake. And I would love to see that collection. I'm sure it's amazing. And certainly, he was not collecting it to look at pictures of underage. I know Paul. He's not into that. So to me, that they went to that much trouble to bust somebody for porno is amazing.
I can only remember Sarah Jessica Parker and Matthew Broderick coming to Pee-wee Herman's defense out loud. They went on television and said, we've seen this collection, it's a treasure, it's worth thousands, it's art, and the man is our friend. Long ago, that could have ruined her. She took a chance doing that.
The charges against Rubens were dropped in exchange for a plea to a misdemeanor obscenity charge and a $100 fine. The implications of being gay severely damaged Rubens' career, and he was not even a romantic lead.
Hi, my name's Andy McDowell, and I just finished this really great film in England called Four Weddings and a Funeral. My co-star is this really lovely guy. He's real handsome, real talented, and now he's my really good friend. He's called,
Hugh.
Hugh!
In the mid-1990s, Hugh Grant was on the verge of superstardom, yet he was plagued by rumors about his sexual orientation. These rumors were quickly put to rest in one of the most notorious cases in Hollywood's history.
Hugh Grant, who's at the height of his career, good-looking, total sweetheart, everybody loves him, dating one of the most beautiful women in the world, Liz Hurley. And what does he do? He goes and picks up on Divine Brown.
Hugh Grant was caught with a prostitute in Hollywood, a not-so-attractive one either, that had every red-blooded male in the world wondering, what is going on here? You're with Liz Hurley and you hook up with a crack whore.
There were rumors of him being gay. He clearly cleared that up. He goes on the Tonight Show, you know, charms his way through the show, laughs at himself, and comes out on top. He's just a darling now.
So it all depends on how it's played, how it's publicized. Hugh Grant, in the long run, you know, that's been beneficial to him.
His career, unlike Paul Rubens, flourished. The implication was clear, that being caught with a low-rent prostitute was better than being thought of as gay. Next, why Hollywood stars continue to stay in the closet.
As much as we like to think that we're open-minded, if somebody is openly gay, it seems that they cannot be a leading man.
I'm engaged. Congratulations. Who's the lucky girl?
I am.
The history of gays in Hollywood has been continual line crossing. 30 years ago, it was considered totally off the boards for a straight actor to play a gay role. That would kill their career if they did this.
What's so interesting to me now, playing gay is almost a prerequisite in an actor's resume. Mm-hmm. You know, almost every actor you can think about has played gay. And we actually have a new crop of actors for whom playing gay is cool. And they give these interviews to the gay press, like people like Hugh Jackman or Jude Law. And they, you know, they say, well, you know, if people want to think I'm gay, that's fine, because they know now that that's what their publicists have said is the way to avoid controversy. In the old days, it would have been, don't think I'm gay. You know, John Travolta in the 1970s would give an interview that, you know, that said, you know, I'm not gay, and if anybody thinks I am, I'll punch him out. You know, whereas these new actors have a very different relationship with these gay parts that they're playing.
I'm cold. Can I get in?
Even though you have straight actors choosing as an act of nobility, okay, to take on a gay role, very few gay actors still want to be known as such. They perhaps rightly feel they will be ghettoized or stereotyped. They will limit the kind of roles that will be offered to them. In some way, it curtails the fantasy life of the mass audience.
It's okay to have a straight actor playing a gay part, but once you put a gay actor playing straight, suddenly that makes everybody nervous, because then they start wondering, well, who else might be playing straight?
So it takes a straight guy like Tom Hanks to make the movie Philadelphia, because people feel secure about that. Well, he's not really gay.
As a kid, you're taught that queers are funny, queers are weird, queers dress up like their mother, that they're afraid to fight, that they're a danger to little kids, and that all they want to do is to get into your pants. And that pretty much sums up the general thinking out there, if you want to know the truth about it.
Thank you for sharing that with me.
It seems that the way that the movie-going public is right now, they will not accept a gay character playing a straight character. As much as we like to think that we're open-minded, if somebody is openly gay, it seems that they cannot be a leading man. Rupert Everett, I mean, he's very handsome, he's a great actor, and one of the very, very few out of the closet homosexuals. And I think that when he came out of the closet, a lot of people were interested to see what will happen to his career.
This film, My Best Friend's Wedding, comes along, and he's cast as Julia Roberts' gay pal. It shows you how times have changed, in that you could have this comedy in which you could have a gay character played by an actual gay actor. They test marketed it, and his cards went through the roof, to the degree that they reshot the ending of the film to put him into it.
And although you quite correctly sense that he is, like most devastatingly handsome single men of his age are, you think, what the hell? Life goes on. Maybe there won't be marriage. Maybe there won't be sex. But by God, there'll be dancing.
There was a sense that Rupert was on the edge of this kind of revolutionary stardom, that he could be an openly gay leading man, and he needed a film to follow My Best Friend's Wedding that would prove it, that proved he wasn't this flash in the pan. And unfortunately, for lots of reasons, The Next Best Thing turned out to be a horrible film.
The Next Best Thing did not only fail to impress critics, it also failed to draw audiences. The film was a colossal box office bomb.
I think a lot of stars were looking to that and saying, you know, if he does it, how will it work out? And I think it was a real setback. And he cannot get a role as a leading man. And I think that a lot of studio heads and a lot of other actors looked at that and said, well, this tells us that we just can't do it. And it means that gay actors and actresses will continue to stay in the closet.
When Anne Heche was living with Ellen DeGeneres, she was cast to star in a film with a major leading man. I believe it was Harrison Ford. And they actually said, well, should we cast her in this? Because she's in a gay relationship, so who will buy on the screen her making love to Harrison Ford?
Ellen DeGeneres has really come back from some very difficult times after she came out as a lesbian.
It was impossible for her to continue that sitcom and play an openly gay character and deal with gay issues. People stopped relating to her. Even the people who weren't necessarily puritanical, her issues were no longer their issues. She might have been fine as a minor character in a TV series, but I think that so far as being the lead character in a sitcom, it presented problems. And in addition to that, there is the puritanical. She got a lot of hate mail over that, a lot of really ugly stuff. So we've still got a long way to go.
But look at her right now. She has the number one new talk show in syndication.
Here she is now, Ellen DeGeneres.
Ellen, as she presents herself in her show, is not a sexual being. She's the lesbian next door. And she's completely taken over the position that was held for a while by Rosie O'Donnell. There seems to be more of a crisis with male sexuality than with female sexuality.
We see an awful lot of straight actors playing gay beautifully. You know, Eric McCormick is a perfect gay man on Will and Grace. I mean, he's brilliant. He's got it right down.
Is this where you line up for Barry Manilow tickets? You're the first one.
A disproportionate number of actors in Hollywood, I would suspect, are gay. And yet, disproportionately, the number of gay parts are played by straight actors. I'm not sure why that is. Is it the gay actors aren't going out for them because they're afraid of being identified and a straight actor can more safely play the part? Or is it producers are saying, you know, I don't want to give that part to an openly gay person? You look at the TV series Queer as Folk and the majority of the actors are straight. It's a little bit like playing blackface, you know, when they wouldn't hire African-American actors in the 1930s. That's offensive now when we look back on it. Will this be offensive someday? I don't know.
In 2003, Vanity Fair devoted its cover to a story on gay Hollywood, yet only one person on the cover was actually gay. Hollywood is quick to lavish praise and recognition to actors taking on risky gay roles, yet the door remains firmly shut for performers wishing to publicly acknowledge their homosexuality. It seems that the Hollywood of today is as much in the closet as it ever was.
There's enough of a facade presented that if you want to believe something about a star, you can. But absolutely, there are definitely gay stars out there who are posing as straight.
Both male and female celebrities who have been plagued with rumors of being gay for years. But they all married spouses who needed a big step up in their careers. Interesting.
True, studios and publicists used to, certainly in the 40s and the 50s, even into the 60s, would control who dated whom. They wanted an arrangement so it was palatable for the screen magazines and the fan magazines. And that goes on somewhat today. And I think that stars today also fool themselves into thinking they have a choice in who they're dating. Whereas in the 50s, Rock Hudson, I think, was assigned to marry his secretary. So there's that illusion that maybe there's a little bit more freedom today when, in fact, there's zero.
Sexuality, it's what drives our interest in celebrities. And that's why so many stars are now eager to keep their private life as much as possible out of the newspapers, is because it makes it harder for the movie-going public to sort of have that fantasy. The more you know about a person's private life, the harder it is for the movie-going public to mold their fantasies into that person.
I think the issue of being gay in Hollywood is still pretty sensitive because in so many instances now, celebrities are really just playing themselves on screen. It really makes it difficult for the audience to lose themselves in the character. I think it's always going to be an issue.
Things can go on behind closed doors. Things can go on even in parties here. But the Hollywood establishment will do anything it can to see to it that the real facts about Hollywood never become so public that they will affect the business of Hollywood.
I think that every person has gay people in their lives, whether it be family members or friends. And I think that in a way, Hollywood likes to keep this closeted homosexual thing as a means to convey just how backwards America is, and that it can't handle, that it's not mature enough to handle that Tom Cruise is gay or not.
What were you like?
before all this? Were you like me, like a girl girl?
Yeah.
There are many different theories on rumors about Hugh Jackman, rumors about Tom Cruise, rumors about Eddie Murphy, the mega movie star matinee idol, Hugh Grant. I've heard them about Hugh Grant. And various reasons on why the public wouldn't want them to be seen as gay. It's all BS. What it is the public, an American public at least, doesn't want anyone gay, period. It took how many years for Ellen DeGeneres to be accepted as being gay? It's a tough battle to be bought gay anything.
It's the same thing as saying, could somebody be president if they were gay? Well, I think at the moment, it would, you know, that attempt would make the great American public shiver and shudder. But I think they might actually get used to it quicker than you think. Because I think that underneath it all, we've made huge advances. And I think the movies, this act of looking at people, this has made homosexuality, bisexuality, much more socially acceptable. I think it's had a big impact. It's opened us up to the way, no matter how heterosexual we may like to think we are, we're very open to alternatives, in fact.
I would love to be able to think that someday that America, the world, could go to a movie and see a love story between two men or two women and see it as a love story and not a gay love story. It's almost impossible to imagine that right now, but it's not inconceivable. It's going to take a while, but I think it eventually might happen.
I can never have children.
We can adopt some.
But you don't understand, Osgood. I'm a man.
Well, nobody's perfect.